Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is George Guidel, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled The Seven Wonders of the Ancient World. Your professor will be Jennifer Tobin. Professor Tobin is an associate professor of classical archaeology at the University of Illinois at Chicago, where she has taught since 1999. Professor Tobin is the author of Black Cilicia, a study of the plain of Issus during the Roman and late Roman periods, and Herodes Atticus and the city of Athens, patronage and conflict under the Antonines. She has participated in excavations in Greece, Cyprus, and Turkey, and leads educational tours of archaeological sites in and around the Mediterranean basin. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites and a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students. And now, we begin the Seven Wonders of the Ancient World, Lecture 1, The List of Wonders.
Hello. This is the first lecture of our course on the Seven Wonders of the Ancient World. This, I think, is a very fascinating topic, and I think at first glance it might seem a bit sensational, the seven great wonders. What are they, and what do they mean? But I think when we look deeper into them, which we will in this course, we will both understand why they were constructed, why they were made, and what they meant at the time of their building, and what they've meant to people since that time. I suppose most people are aware that the list of the seven wonders exists, but few people can actually name all seven. But what fewer people realize is that the list was never static, even in antiquity. Certain monuments were added to the list, certain were detracted from the list, depending on the time period, the desires of the people making up the list, their religious affiliations, personal taste. All of these came into account when the lists were created. And I say lists because, as you'll hear, over time there were many lists of seven wonders. Even though there were many lists, the number rarely varied from the number seven. And of course, the number seven has a talismanic quality to it. We all know about the seven deadly sins, the seven seas, the seven hills of Rome. So the seven wonders simply is part of that great list of that magical number. So now let's talk a little bit about the word wonder, or wonders. In Greek, the word for wonders is thaumata, and it's very close to another Greek word that is theamata. Theamata means things that ought to be seen. And some scholars have played with the idea that the initial list of seven wonders weren't thaumata, wonders, but simply theamata, things that ought to be seen. I think about a book that's out today, the however many things that you should see before you die. This may have been a list rather like that, list of theamata, things to be seen. And of course, you can tell, even listening, that the word theamata and thaumata sound a great deal like one another. It's easy to see how a book or a treatise written on things to be seen could then easily evolve into things that are wonders. So that's kind of an etymological explanation of the word wonders. But I think we have to agree that the word wonders, to us, elicits, of course, a remarkable response. Things that are wondered at. You wonder at something because you cannot begin to understand how it was created. And certainly that is a subtext of all of the things we'll be studying, is that through time, and even today, we marvel at how these things could be achieved, how they can be created. But today, of course, we look back on the ancient people who had a limited tool set, and we wonder, how could they create the pyramids with only bronze tools? But even in antiquity, people didn't understand how these things could be achieved. And so the wonder quality of these buildings and statues that we'll be studying, hopefully, will come through in my lectures, because I agree with the ancient and modern assessment that these seven buildings and statues we will look at are truly marvelous and wonderful, and in many ways mysterious, because we really can't understand how they might be achieved. The so-called canonical list, the list that most of us think of when we think of the list of wonders, was actually drawn up in the 16th century AD by a Dutch artist, Martin van Heemskerk, and he produced a set of drawings of the seven wonders that he compiled from his reading of many, many ancient authors. And in fact, we'll be talking about Martin van Heemskerk, but not until the very last lecture of this course. The list that he compiled contained two statues, the statue of Zeus from Olympia and the Colossus of Rhodes, as well as two sets of tombs, the pyramids of Egypt and the mausoleum of Halicarnassus. Other buildings too existed on his list, the Temple of Artemis at Ephesus and the walls of Babylon. He kind of put that together with another monument from Babylon, the famous Hanging Gardens. And then his last entry in the list was the Lighthouse of Alexandria. But it needs to be noted here that in antiquity, never did these particular monuments and statues stand together on a list. He put this list together. But because his list is one that everybody kind of turns to today for the list of the seven wonders, I'm going to talk about the monuments that feature on his list first. I will examine how they were built and why they were built. And then we'll look at other lists and look at other monuments that, from time to time, occupied lists of seven wonders in the Greek, Roman, and medieval world. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the organization of this course. In our 14 lectures, I will spend two lectures on some of the wonders. Some of the wonders I think are so interesting and exciting that I'm going to have to give them a little extra time. So, say the pyramids of Egypt, for example, will warrant two lectures. Other monuments we don't know that much about, so I'll talk about them for perhaps just one lecture. In all cases, I'll be talking about how these things were built and why, and then I'll talk about later readings of these monuments. And I mean readings in that the Egyptians built the pyramids, but what did the Greeks think about them? What did the Romans think about them? What did the Christians and the Muslims think about them? I will be relying on archaeology to understand these monuments, but I also will be drawing very deeply on literary testimonia. Sometimes these people don't really understand what they're looking at, but what they think these buildings are is just as interesting to me as what the buildings really stood for by the builders themselves. So we will, for example, taking our example of the pyramids of Egypt, we'll see that the pyramids were built as tombs, but by the medieval period, they were thought to be granaries, and nobody believed they were tombs. So I think what's interesting about these monuments that are part of the Seven Wonder list is that over time, they take on a whole variety of meanings. So indirectly, it was Alexander the Great who was responsible for the creation of the list of the seven wonders. The world in which he lived, the 4th century BC, consisted of a war-torn Greece that had recently been conquered by his father, Philip of Macedon, and just across the Aegean was the vast Persian Empire that stretched from the west coast of Turkey to the Indus River. It was the dream of Alexander's father, Philip, to conquer Persia, and Philip himself was assassinated before he could do this, so Alexander, when he became king at the age 20, picked up that idea and marched into Persian territory in 334 BC. He was invading a huge empire, an empire that was drawn up from thousands of different cultures and societies. And in just over 10 years, Alexander conquered this vast terrain. He died in the city of Babylon in 323 BC, having become the new king of Persia, the master of all the lands. And Babylon, as we'll see, was the site of several wonders that we'll be studying. At the time of Alexander's death, then, he controlled not only Greece and Macedonia, but the Persian Empire. And all of these different people that lived there, Persians, Babylonians, Egyptians, Syrians, Carians, and more. Before he died, Alexander instituted a number of quite controversial policies that he hoped would give him better control over this myriad of people. And many of these policies were highly disapproved of by his Greek and Macedonian soldiers, because what Alexander did was embrace Persian culture. He wore Persian costume. He took a Persian wife. He encouraged his soldiers to marry Persian women. He trained Persian boys to enter the military. For many of the Greeks and Macedonians who had been at war with Persia, this was very troubling. But in fact, when you look at it dispassionately, Alexander was doing something quite rational. He was finding a way to rule a multicultural empire by making himself acceptable to most of the people. And the reason why I talk about this now is that we will see that there is a strong feeling of multiculturalism that is wrapped into the list of seven wonders. Part of the allure of many of these monuments is that they came from exotic lands like Babylon, like Persia. Less controversial was Alexander's habit of founding Greek-style cities in the East. This was another way of controlling this vast empire, and he quite sensibly saw that if he implanted Greek and Macedonian cities in the Persian heartland, he would easily, or perhaps more easily, control these regions. Not only would he have a power base there, but the men he left there would interact with the locals, probably marry local women, and in fact bring Greek culture into this area, and through acculturation, make this area easier to control. Alexander founded 30 cities, or more, 30 we know about, most of them named after himself, very modestly, most of them called Alexandria, though he named one after his horse Bucephalus and one after his favorite dog. But Alexander founded these cities, and they were quite successful in the short term, at least, bringing Greek culture to this eastern terrain. But actually, this mode of transmission worked both ways, because eventually many of the Greeks living in the east returned back to their homeland, bringing eastern technology, eastern ideas. So the world that Alexander hoped to conquer, in fact, began to infuse Greek society itself. So in a way, Alexander opened up pathways between the East and the West that had never before existed. And this, again, is part of this multicultural aspect of the Seven Wonders I will be talking more about in the lectures to come. As I mentioned, Alexander died at Babylon at the age of 33. Babylon was the city that he had hoped to use as an eastern capital for his empire. And when he died, unfortunately, his vast empire could not hold together. And various of his generals fought to get a piece of his empire, a piece of the pie. So the period after Alexander's death is a period where we have most of his empire divided amongst strong leaders, strong kings. And we call this period, the three centuries after Alexander's death, the Hellenistic period, and I'll be using this term, so I should define it for you. It's the time in which the world of Greece, and in antiquity, the word for Greece is Hellas, the Greeks are Hellenes, so you get the word Hellenistic. Anyway, the world of Greece at this time was influenced by societies of the East. And so we call this Hellenistic because it's Hellenic, but with an Eastern twist. It's a fascinating period of history, a very rich and prosperous time, but one filled with violence. Many of these generals that had carved out pieces of Alexander's empire went to war with one another, hoping to create larger empires, some even hoping to recreate Alexander's empire. These kings not only competed on the battlefield, they competed in the realm of culture as well. In the arena of literature and the arts, many of these kings presented themselves not just as great leaders, but as great patrons of the arts. And we see in these Hellenistic cities that develop the creation of libraries and museums where philosophers and scientists and artists were supported and nurtured to create a cultural center in each of these cities. And it's within that kind of cultural milieu we see the rise of the Seven Wonders list. So the list could only have existed in the wake of Alexander's empire, in the aftermath of his bringing together multicultures and then having them break apart under these kings who in turn supported the arts. The most stable of these Hellenistic kingdoms was one founded by Alexander's childhood friend, Ptolemy. Ptolemy was perhaps one of Alexander's most far-sighted of friends, and when he knew Alexander was dead, he chose probably the best section of Alexander's empire to take claim to, Egypt. Egypt, of course, in antiquity, long before Alexander, had been perhaps the greatest kingdom ever seen, with incredible riches created by the fine agriculture in that nation. The Nile River, of course, famously would overflow its banks every year and bring silt and fresh water to the fields, allowing crops to grow. Even twice a year, they could have a wheat harvest. But by the time that Alexander had conquered Egypt, Egypt was a weak shadow of itself. Nevertheless, Ptolemy, when he was trying to create his own new kingdom, thought Egypt was the best and richest place that he could control. Of all these Hellenistic kingdoms, the kingdom set up by Ptolemy in Egypt was by far the most successful, the most long-lived. In fact, the last of Ptolemy's descendants to rule Egypt was Cleopatra, the famous Cleopatra who was conquered by Rome. When Alexander came through Egypt, he founded a new city there, a city called Alexandria. What else? That's what he called his cities. And this city we will talk quite a bit about in the coming lectures, but I'll say a little bit about it today. The city was located on the Mediterranean and was set up to be essentially a Greek-style city within this Egyptian context. Alexander laid out the city, he chose its location, he chose its name, but after doing so, he went eastward into Syria and deeper into what is today Iran, Iraq, and India, and he never returned. So it was up to Ptolemy I to create this great city, to really build it up, and he did so in a magnificent fashion. We usually refer to this man as Ptolemy I, with his nickname Soter, because all of the Ptolemaic kings had the name Ptolemy, so it's rather confusing. So Ptolemy I, Soter, that is, the savior, built up Alexandria with the help of his son Ptolemy II, whose nickname was Philadelphus. These Ptolemies get very confusing, I know. But together, father and son created a Greek city on Egyptian soil that was complete with a theater, an agora, that is to say a marketplace, and a gymnasium, that is an athletic center. These qualities, these cultural buildings of a theater and a market and a gymnasium were quite alien to Egyptian culture, but were just intrinsic to life in a Greek city. So this is what I mean when I say that they created a Greek city on Egyptian soil. But what Ptolemy I did, which was rather unique, was he created a library, the first public library of the ancient world. Now, of course, libraries had already existed, but libraries usually were associated with private households, with a palace, and so the purview of a king. But Ptolemy I was unique in that he opened the library to the people at large. And this was going to become the greatest center of learning in the ancient world. Now, it was the library's mission to collect copies of all works of science and literature that existed at the time. And this was no small ambition. Legend has it that all ships that entered the port of Alexandria were searched, and if they had any pieces of literature, these had to be relinquished to the library. At the library, they would be copied so that the shelves would contain every known work in the world. Not just works of literature were collected, works of science as well, and philosophy, but also works that were not Greek, works that came from areas farther east, astrological treatises from Babylon, and histories from Persia, and myths from Mesopotamia. So it was here, for example, that the Greeks first translated the Hebrew Bible. So the so-called Old Testament was first translated into Greek here at this library. So this was a repository of all known learning, starting in the 3rd century BC. Now, because so many works needed to be organized and studied, a coterie of librarians and professional scholars became attached to the library. And these men shared a mania for organizing. They cataloged and they made lists of all sorts of types of knowledge. And we know the names of many of these librarians. Many of them were extremely famous writers and scientists on their own. One of these was a man named Callimachus. And he was from the Greek city of Cyrene in North Africa. Again, you can see the multiculturalism of the period. He lived around 305 to 240 BC, and he was a prolific author. One of the works that he wrote was called A Collection of Wonders in Lands Throughout the World. This is frustrating because, in fact, we know the title of this work, but the work itself does not survive. As you might be aware, many, many things that were written in antiquity have not survived to us today. The Great Library at Alexandria, where all known works of learning resided, was burned several times, once by Julius Caesar in the 1st century BC and later in early medieval times. So, unfortunately, although we know this work existed, we don't know what it said. But even the title gives us some interesting insight as to what Callimachus was trying to do. He doesn't say how many wonders he's talking about. He simply says a collection of wonders. So we don't know whether he was dealing with seven or more. But he calls them wonders in lands throughout the world. And I think this part is quite important because it tells us that he was viewing the list as being something that expanded beyond the normal knowledge of the Greeks. After all, Alexander had taken his army all the way to India, but these were areas that most people couldn't visit. And so this catalog that Callimachus was creating was looking at the wonders that existed across the known world. We're a little bit better informed in the next century. In the 2nd century BC, we have our actual first list of wonders. And the list survives as an epigram, that is a short poem, composed by a Greek author named Antipater. He came from the city of Sidon, which is today located in Lebanon. And so again, we're seeing how in the Hellenistic world were so much expanded from the normal peninsula of Greece, where we have Greek authors from Syria working in Egypt in a library devoted to literature and learning. So we have this poem. This poem actually comes down to us, and I'll read it to you so you get a sense of the kind of data we're working from to get the seven wonders and what Antipater has to say for us. I have gazed on the walls of impregnable Babylon, along which chariots may race, and on the Zeus by the banks of the Alpheus. I have seen the Hanging Gardens and the Colossus of Helios, the great man-made mountain of the lofty pyramids and the gigantic tomb of Mausolus. But when I saw the sacred house of Artemis that towers to the clouds, the others were placed in the shade, for the sun himself has never looked upon its equal outside Olympus. So he gives us a list of seven. He lists the walls of Babylon, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, the statue of Zeus at Olympia, the Colossus of Rhodes, the pyramids, the mausoleum of Halicarnassus, and the Temple of Artemis at Ephesus. And this is the one he thinks is the best. So we will come back to his assessment in a few lectures when we actually talk about that building. There may have been earlier lists than his, but his is the first we have in total. One monument that's missing from that list is the Lighthouse of Alexandria. That does not appear on a list until the 6th century AD. Nevertheless, I'll be talking about that monument in depth in a few lectures. So Antipater is looking at these monuments with wonder and talking about the fact that he actually visited many of them. He says, I've gazed on the walls of Babylon, and I've seen the Hanging Gardens. Certainly he would have been able to go to Babylon, though it would have been a 1,000-mile trip for him. But essentially, we have to imagine that this list is being created because most people cannot visit these monuments. Most people only hear about these monuments through the spoken word or the word on the page. So I want to talk about another early list we have of the seven wonders. Again, perhaps from the Hellenistic period. This list comes to us from a man named Philo from the city of Byzantium. And Byzantium is today the city of Constantinople or Istanbul. Now, Philo is a bit of a puzzle for us. We know that he was an engineer who lived in the 3rd century BC, and he wrote some very, very complicated treatises about how things were constructed. He was essentially an engineer, very interested in warcraft. He built siege equipment. He talked about breaching walls and so on. So we know he lived sometime in the 3rd century BC. He provides a short treatise on the seven wonders of the ancient world. The trouble with this treatise is that many scholars have read it and thought that the language use couldn't possibly be that of the 3rd century BC. It's much too flowery. It doesn't match the language use that other works by Philo use. So most scholars today think that the treatise on the seven wonders of the ancient world attributed to Philo actually must have been written by a different author, a much later author, in the 4th century AD. And scholars do debate about this, but certainly the way his language sounds is quite different from his other works, and so perhaps we should accept that it is some mistake in the literature, and in fact, this work dates a bit later. That isn't so terribly important. I am interested in this work because of what he tells us about his intent, and perhaps how it might reflect the intent I have in this course that I'm presenting to you right now. So let's look at his introduction, because we will be looking at his whole treatise from time to time with different monuments. The list he uses is the exact same list of Antipater, so he has the same seven that Antipater used. So this is what he has to say about them. Everyone has heard of each of the seven wonders of the world, but few have seen all of them for themselves. To do so, one has to go abroad to Persia, cross the Euphrates River, travel to Egypt, spend time among the Elians in Greece, go to Halicarnassus in Caria, sail to Rhodes, and see Ephesus in Ionia. Only if you travel the world and get worn out by the effort of the journey will the desire to see all the wonders of the world be satisfied, and by the time you have done that, you will be old and practically dead. Because of this, education can perform a remarkable and valuable task. It removes the necessity of travel, displays the beautiful and amazing things in one's very own home, and allows one to see these things with the mind's eye, if not with one's eye. So what Philo is telling us is that by his day, perhaps the 4th century AD, one really cannot reasonably travel to see all the seven wonders. It's just too difficult. And to do so would wear you out. And he offers his treatise, he offers his work to bring essentially the wonders to you, to the reader. And that's what I'm doing with you as well. I myself haven't been able to see all of the wonders. I've actually been to the location of most of them. But through this course, my goal is to present them to you with as much archaeological information as possible, as well as literary documentation, and allow you, in your mind's eye, while you're sitting at home, like Philo's readers, or driving in your car, perhaps, allow you to reconstruct these wonders in your own imagination. I think that's what the wonders are really about. They're about imagination, about how remarkable these structures are, how could they have been created, and why. And my focus in this course will not just be the nuts and bolts of construction, but I will talk about the remarkable stories that surround these wonders, because in my opinion, although the architecture and technique is fascinating, I think what's more interesting is the human side to these things. And as you'll see, all of these wonders have quite a lot of legends attached to them. They have romances and murders and all kinds of exciting tales. Because I think when you see these wonderful monuments, it creates in the human mind a desire to elaborate, to tell stories, and to create a narrative that tells us why these things could possibly exist. And so in the next several lectures, that's what I'll be doing, trying to explain how these existed and why they've always been sources of excitement over the last several thousand years.
The Seven Wonders of the Ancient World, Lecture 2. The Great Pyramids of Giza, Part 1.
In my last lecture, I talked about how the list of the Seven Wonders was created and the Hellenistic world of the 3rd and 2nd century BC that fostered the interest in the wonderful, the foreign, and remarkable structures from all over the world. So what I plan to do in these lectures coming up is to talk about each of the seven wonders in chronological order, that is to say, in the order in which they were constructed. So Pride of Place begins with the oldest, by far, of these wonders, the pyramids. Probably if I asked anybody on the street what were the seven wonders of the ancient world, most people would come up with the pyramids. I think that one is pretty much well known. But what isn't clear, perhaps, at first glance, and certainly what isn't clear in some of the early testimonia of the seven wonders, is which pyramids? Because in fact, in Egypt, there were over 100 pyramids that were constructed. Our earliest list of wonders, that of Antipater, that I read to you in the last lecture, he's quite vague. He simply marvels at the huge labor of the sheer pyramids. Fortunately for us, later authors, including Philo of Byzantium, who I talked about a little bit ago, and another author we'll be talking more about, two authors actually, Diodorus Siculus and Strabo, these men agree that the pyramids that were particularly wonderful were those near the ancient city of Memphis at a place we call today Giza, the Giza Plateau. And here, during the 26th and 25th centuries BC, three monumental tombs were constructed, each for a different pharaoh, and all of these combined were destined to be counted among the seven wonders. Now, to visit Giza today is quite easy. It's just in the suburbs of Cairo, though when the pyramids were constructed, Cairo did not exist. When you visit the pyramids and you can, from one side of them, you can look out into the desert, and then you turn your back and you are in the cityscape of Cairo. So the pyramids, at least, are one of the easier sets of wonders to visit. What I'd like to do in order to situate the pyramids of Giza into a historical and architectural context, I want to talk about pyramid design in Egypt, because in many ways the pyramids of Giza were the culmination in pyramid design. However, the origins of pyramids go back at least a century or more. In around 2630 BC, an architect named Imhotep created the first pyramid in Egypt for his king, Pharaoh Djoser. This took place at a place called Saqqara, which is just south of Giza. Before Imhotep made this step, for centuries, royalty had been buried in what archaeologists call mastaba tombs, large rectangular structures of stone that sat over a burial chamber that was in the ground. And within the mastaba structure, there were tombs designed for the worship of the deceased, as well as storage of goods for the afterlife. Imhotep was inspired to enhance his pharaoh's mastaba tomb by stacking smaller rectangular forms above the initial structure, thus creating a stepped pyramid of six layers. This was high, it measured 200 feet. And so this step pyramid then was rather revolutionary. It enhanced a rather simple structure and made it this high staircase to the stars. In order to kind of get a sense of what pyramids are about, we need to situate the pharaoh in Egyptian society and religion. The pharaoh was much more than just the king of Egypt. The pharaoh was a semi-divine being who, when he died, he would certainly be with the gods, and on earth was the personification of the god Horus. The pharaoh had many, many important things to do with his time on earth, but his basic job was to maintain order, or mat, in Egypt, by observing religious ceremonies, by living a just life. And one of the things that the pharaoh was actually responsible for was the flooding of the Nile. And I already mentioned, I think in the last lecture, that the Nile floods every year, bringing soil and water to the fields so that the desert land of Egypt can grow an immense amount of food. And it was thought that the pharaoh was responsible for maintaining the balance that allowed this to happen. So honoring the pharaoh in death was an important aspect of Egyptian life. And making these impressive tombs were, in a sense, helping the pharaoh to fulfill his last duty in life, that is to die and to be with the gods. And so in 2630 BC, when Imhotep built the first pyramid, he was building it not just for the pharaoh Djoser, but for the good of Egypt itself. The subsequent pyramids that were constructed continued this wonderful concept of enhancement of the pharaoh's tomb. In the next century, in the year 2599 BC, when the pharaoh Huni reigned, he built a pyramid for himself just like Djoser's that was stepped, but he took this idea to a higher level by filling in the steps to make a smooth-sided pyramid, the kind of pyramid we think of when we think of the pyramids. The next development that gets us closer to the concept of the true pyramid, that is a pyramid with smooth sides, was done by Huni's son, a man named Snefru, who lived about 2550 BC. Now, he's credited with being a great pyramid builder. He was the first to build the true pyramid, whose sides, from the start, were designed to be sheer. But what we can see here, and what I'm trying to demonstrate, is that pyramid construction was, in fact, in many ways, trial and error. And we see this very clearly with the works of Snefru, because the first pyramid he constructs, and in fact he constructs several, but the first one he constructs is called today the Bent Pyramid, because the slope of the tomb initially was at a very steep angle of 55 degrees, but halfway up the pyramid, the slope shifts to a gentler angle of 43 degrees. So if you looked at this pyramid, you'd see that from the base, it's going up at a steep angle, and then there's this kind of bend in the pyramid, why it's called the Bent Pyramid. So it's clear that something happened in the construction, that they're still working out the process of creating these pyramids. Snefru built a second pyramid, not too far away from the first, the so-called Red Pyramid, and the slope of that pyramid is 43 degrees, which is the exact slope of the upper part of the earlier pyramid he built. So I'm just trying to show you that pyramids were not gifts from aliens or anything cuckoo like that. Pyramids were, for centuries, structures that architects tried to build and had to work through many, many problems until they became a finalized form. The son of Snefru, the man who built those last two pyramids, was a man named Khufu. That's his Egyptian name. Often we think of him by his Greek name, and I'll talk about how he got a Greek name in my next lecture. The Greek name of Khufu is Cheops, and that might be a name that you're familiar with. Cheops is credited with building the greatest pyramid of all time. He obviously ordered the pyramid to be built. It was his architect who constructed it. Around 2550 BC, his architects began the largest pyramid ever constructed. When complete, it stood 500 feet tall, with a base measuring over 700 feet square. And its sheer sides had an angle of 51 degrees. And so that's much more steep than Snefru's second pyramid of 43 degrees, but not quite as steep as the lower portion of Snefru's first pyramid, which was 55. So it's clear that the architects sort of saw that 43 degrees was perhaps not as interesting, 55 was too challenging, 51 seems to be the ideal angle for the pyramids, and most subsequent pyramids follow that angle. Now, it's thought that 2.5 million limestone blocks were used in the creation of this pyramid. Many of these weighed around 2.5 tons. So it's not surprising at all that this building was deemed a wonder in antiquity and is still deemed a wonder today. I think anyone who has seen the pyramids, has walked next to them, you cannot but be amazed at the size of these things. Khufu, and I prefer to use his Egyptian name, even though we may be more familiar with the name Cheops. Khufu chose a new site for his pyramid, the plateau of Giza, as I mentioned just a minute ago. The way the pyramid was constructed seems to be the fact that the foundations of the pyramid were cut into the limestone bedrock that the plateau was created from. The position of the tomb, like all pyramids, was oriented to the cardinal points, that is, north, south, east, west. The way the Egyptians did this was based on the observation of the rising of the sun and the movement of the stars, using very simple equipment to point the building, orient it on the north star. Because the Giza Plateau is mostly limestone, the quarries used to create the pyramids were right there. They, in fact, quarried the stones for the pyramids at just adjacent to the pyramid itself. That is to say, the interior stones of the pyramid. But like all pyramids, the outer facing was created out of a finer stone. And this was limestone from a quarry about 10 miles away, from a place called Tura.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.